Okay, welcome to Writers on Writing, and that's Gary Bartz in the background. I've known Rivers with Langston Hughes, and this is your host, Brenda Greene. We are in the studios of Mega Evers College over the airways of WNYE 91.5 FM, and we come to you every week to give you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers talk about their work, their lives, and their crafts. And I am director of the Center for Black Literature and the National Black Writers Conference. Very pleased to have in the studio with me today, Vivien Goldman.
Hello, Brenda. I'm so pleased to be here.
Welcome, and thank you for coming. And Vivien Goldman has written a very, very complex, I would say, book, a very important book that contributes to our knowledge about Bob Marley, The Book of Exodus, The Making and Meaning of Bob Marley and the Wailers, Album of the Century. And this book is, as I said, very complex. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the book, but first I want to tell you a little bit about Vivien, and she can also fill in. She's a writer, book broadcaster, and musician who's devoted much of her work to Afro-Caribbean and global music. She's also adjunct professor of punk and reggae at NYU's Clive Davis Department of Recorded Music. And you can hear when you heard Vivien talk, she's originally from London, right?
Yeah.
But now resides in New York City. And this is your fifth book.
Yeah.
Okay. You want to share a little bit more about your background and how you came to write this book?
Yeah, it seems to be a bit of a cognitive dissonance for some people, you know, like nice Jewish girl from Golders Green writing, you know, writing a Bob Marley book. Actually, I wrote his first biography as well. But what can I say? It was just like my path was led to do this sort of stuff, you know, unbeknownst to me. I mean, I didn't plan it is what I'm trying to say. After I left university, where I studied English and American literature.
Okay.
Yes. I sort of, shortly thereafter, I, as luck would have it, got a job that involved working with Bob Marley, doing his press at a time when the papers were so very deeply uninterested in him that it was a real, you had to go out on the front line and fight to get him coverage, which I was honored to do, you know, because he was so great.
And what year was this about?
That was in 1975. And he at that time played the concert at the Lyceum that was to be very pivotal in his career and turned things around. They had that live version of No Woman, No Cry at that time that really touched a lot of people. And anyway, I did that for 7 months and then I left and went into full-time writing. But then I wound up being, certainly for England, probably the writer who wrote most about Bob. And I think I have a funny feeling this may have been because he already knew me and I'd been in his corner before and he knew I'd fought for him and got him a lot of press. So I think that that helped me get access to him as a writer. Because when I look back on it, one of the reasons why I wrote the book was I started to think about this period of his liberty, as it were. I was thinking how incredibly significant it was, and I was kind of running over it in my mind, oh, this happened, you know, the shooting when they tried to kill him at his home in Hope Road in December 1976, and I'd left the house just the day before, and then the making of the Exodus album, I was there a lot because they recorded it about three blocks from my house. Then the peace concert, hang on, I was there. And I started to realize as a writer, because I never saw it covered the way I felt it, lived it, saw the people, knew the people, talked to the people who lived and laid their lives on the line, and many died. And I thought, nobody's telling their story. Who? So I thought, hello, that must be my job.
Yeah, and I think one of the things that I think strikes me in this book is that I feel like I'm in a conversation with you, that this, that your voice is very, very strong in the book. And the book is not only about the making of Exodus, but you have history, you have politics, you really give the reader a context for what was happening, the social context, the historical context, the political context. And so that you end up almost like with kind of an intimate portrait of who Bob Marley is, the man, and then how he came to write the album, and then, or not write the album, how he came to produce and create the album. And then you also do an analysis of all the songs in the album.
Well, you know, that was the least I can do, do. You know what I mean? As a music critic and that, and in fact, I even reviewed Exodus when it came out in 76. But what it was, I mean, trust me, it took me 2.5 years to write this book. And by the end, I was seeing everything in terms of Exodus. There was nothing that wasn't.
You were dreaming Exodus, right? Yes, I understand. I've been dreaming freedom songs recently.
Oh, interesting. Hope to hear more about that. Yeah. Well, you know, so perhaps, don't mean to be a cliche, perhaps inevitably writing the book did take me on my own Exodus. You know what I mean?
Yes.
So I started out thinking I was going to write a making of the album book, and I knew I was going to cover that particular, which I thought was somewhat neglected previously, time span between the shooting and the peace concert. So that is between 76 and 78. But lo and behold, as I start to do my research, things crop up and I suddenly realize, kaboing, there's a whole load more that I hadn't even envisaged or thought of in this story. And so it catapulted me, really, something I could never have thought of in a million years that I wound up writing. I mean, I knew I'd write about musical, even political, but I never thought I would wind up really writing about the spiritual. But it took me there.
Which was very much a part of his music. Why don't you talk a little bit more, as you mentioned, sort of your own Exodus, and you talk in the book about Exodus and the meaning, the multiple meanings of Exodus and what it's meant historically, what it meant for him. And can you elaborate a little bit more on Exodus?
Well, for a start, I mean, to be honest, I'm so into it that we could be blathering on about it for hours, but we haven't got much time, so I'll try to keep it tight.
Right.
Okay, I discovered that not really many people in America seem to know. They seem to know more in England, where I come from. I was surprised people didn't even realize that his own countrymen had tried to kill Bob Marley. Somehow this crucial factor got lost for many people, even people who are Bob fans. So what happened was that Bob got caught up. He was intended to be a sacrificial lamb in the deadly downtown rivalries between the Jamaican Labour Party, headed by Edward Seaga, popularly known as Seaga, for his, you know, backing from the American government, and Michael Manley's People's National Party, the PNP. So Bob, having had some success in the wider world, had got access, he'd gained control of this house on Hope Road, which was uptown, sort of where the posh people lived. You know, he was next door to the Prime Minister, Michael Manley. And this was very unusual for, you know, for people from the ghetto to even ever get up there. There wasn't, you know, it wasn't even a bus you could take there, let alone take over a big old property. And Bob liked to think of it, the way he put it to me was, he said, Vivien, he used to call me Vivien, I'm trying to bring the ghetto uptown. Okay. So he encouraged people from the rival parties to meet and mingle, and he was hoping that more peace would arise.
Right, that comes across in his music, the cutting across class in general.
Well, this is a whole other story, because Bob was so uniquely placed, being, you know, having been catapulted between different strata of society, going from a very rural situation in trench, you know, in the country, to trench town, not really knowing his father, being light skinned when normally at that time being light skinned as opposed to being darker skinned gave you more access to the fruits of society. Anyway, these are huge epic things, but Bob was, as I say, uniquely placed to channel a lot of different feelings from different classes and races through his being as an artist. But anyway, back to where we were at Hope Road. People broke into his house and tried to kill him, who in my book I reveal is pretty seems that they came from the Seaga side of the JLP, the Jamaican Labour Party. So Bob did go on and play the Smile Jamaica concert that he'd been scheduled to play, which had been, you know, the bone of contention. But then he was basically sent off on his little exodus, or his run, not little, yes, you know, on his big exodus. And It was while he was essentially a political exile and refugee that he was drawn to consider the theme of Exodus and to interpret it in that majestic anthem that very likely many of the listeners know well. And when I was talking to him about that period later, like a couple of years later, when he was back at Hope Road in his studio making the Survival album, he made a little comment to me that didn't really strike me at the time, but just leaped from the tape when I went back to listen to it to do this book many years later. He actually muttered to me, we were contemplating that period in London, and he actually muttered to me, "I was a stranger in a strange land."
Okay. Stranger in a strange
land. That yes. does actually come from yes. Exodus, as in God's own Bible's yes. book yes. of Exodus.
You said he always kept his book.
Yeah, he always... Well, he was a devout Rasta, and anybody who knows Rastas know that if you're really doing the right thing, you do read a chapter a day, is the Rasta way. So that showed to me how he really had perceived it through the lens of Exodus, and that I wasn't wrong, I wasn't barking up the wrong tree in extending it in this way. And really what happened was that I went to interview Family Man, the bass player of the Wailers, and a friend of mine said to me, "Oh, ask them if they were familiar with the theme from Exodus." Now, many young people are probably listening to this show who may not remember. There was a very popular film. Do you remember,
yes,
Brenda?
Yes, I do.
Very popular film called Exodus,
yes,
directed by Otto Preminger, starring Paul Newman.
And what's the woman's
name? What's her name again?
But St. Clair.
Rather embarrassing.
Eva St.
Thank you so much.
Eva St. Marie.
Yeah, yes. I think that was it.
Yes.
So it was a story relating to the transition as it then was, without wanting to use the wrong words, when Israel was being founded and the Jews were, being killed by the Nazis. And there was this one particular boat that was sent by turned up at Palestine, and the British didn't want to let them in. Well, of course, regardless of what has happened subsequently, which I'm sure is a whole other conversation for another day, the fact of the matter is that at that point in time, that story had great resonance for all oppressed peoples everywhere. And it's certainly in Jamaica it had a huge impact. And in fact, on the B-side of Bob's first single, before he was in the Wailers, they have a version of that theme from Exodus, from the film, performed by Ernest Ranglin, the guitar supremo of Jamaica.
Okay.
And so he didn't know about Exodus. But what happened was, while they were in London on the exile, Family Man went to Soho, where they had the secondhand record stores, and he bought this record, and it was great movie soundtracks. So he took it back to their flat, and they were listening to it, and smoke a big spliff, listen to the beautiful music, and on it was Exodus, a song they knew well. But there they were, listening to it again, doubtless not having heard it for some time. And Family Man explained to me how they were kind of rocked anew by its grandeur and the emotion in it that really touches the listener with making it such a huge hit. Lo and behold, like next day, here comes Bob with his version of Exodus. And they actually flipped the actual music. And because in the theme from Exodus, from the film, it goes... it goes... Bum, 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 bum. Ba-dum. And Family Man changed it so that the famous bass line goes bum, 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 bum. So Family Man actually sang it to me, how he'd, tuned into it and riffed on it.
Yes.
So that's what gave me the idea that the quest of Exodus is very deep in the DNA of Bob's Exodus.
Yes, and as you said, it resonates in Jamaican culture, society. It resonates all over the world.
As you say, in every liberation struggle, in Poland, everywhere,
the whole concept,
tune into Exodus.
The whole concept.
Yeah.
You talk a little bit also about the history of Jamaican music. Can you just briefly... give us just very briefly, because we're going to have to take a short break in a minute.
Well, Jamaican music, the motto is out of many, one people. And true enough, the same is true of the music. And I have to say that we no longer, unfortunately, have the indigenous Jamaicans, which is the Taino, Arawak Indians, because they were all killed shortly after the Spanish landed. Mm-hmm. But they had their own violin, and the violin was an early strand in Jamaican music, and I'll tell we have to come back in a minute and talk about it more.
Okay, so we're going to take a very short break, and when we come back, we'll continue talking about some of the themes that are in Exodus, the album, and the issues that came up. Stay.
Inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes.
On Saturday, March 31st,
and he wrote a poem.
The Center for Black Literature at Medgar Evers College is sponsoring a tribute to Barb Marley, lyrical poet. The tribute will be held in Founders Auditorium at Medgar Evers College, 1650 Bedford Avenue. Kwame Dawes, author of Barb Marley, Lyrical Genius, is our keynote speaker. Celebrated author Colin Channer will moderate. Our panel will consist of Christopher John Farley, Vivien Goldman, and Dara Tompkins. A special musical performance by the Imani Dancers of Medgar Evers College will be held, and Taj Weeks and Adowa will do a musical tribute to Barb Marley. Please call 718-270-6976 for more information at 718-270-6976.
Okay, thank you, Fritz. Fritz is my engineer today. I want to thank him for staying this afternoon with me as we tape this program. And we are in the studio with Vivien. Vivien?
Hello.
Vivien? Yes.
Vivien Goldman.
Yes, yes.
Watcha.
Yes, and we were just talking about Jamaican music and the whole concept of Exodus. Now, one of the things you talk about is Exodus being a concept album. And some of the what are some of the themes that come out? When you elaborate on that?
Well, it's funny old thing because it shows how making a record is really a group thing, because the flow of Exodus, the track listing, wasn't actually done by Bob. It was done by Chris Blackwell, who founded the label and was sort of the executive producer.
Mm-hmm.
But Bob did sort of respect him artistically. And in fact, when he came back with his suggested running order, Bob and Family Man, who's like his lieutenant, they went for it. So it turned out to be very deep and in a particular way that had, it was in a sense almost stronger or was, hello?
Keep going.
Was extremely striking when... it was extremely striking when it was on a record as it was originally with a side A and a side B, because what happened was the side A, the first side, was sort of like the heavy side, and then side B was the lighter side. But also it has a different meaning now when you listen to it all the way through on a CD, you mm-hmm. see, because that's how...
Oh, that's because you don't have the different sides.
That's right. That's how. But it's sort of, you know, I guess it makes it even more of a smoother journey, maybe less obvious than when you actually had to turn it over to get from one mm-hmm. side to the other. But it really is like the cycle of life. I'm not kidding. I don't mean to sound pretentious. It's really like the cycle of death and rebirth that goes on in the Exodus album, because... in a way, obviously, he's expunging on some level some of the trauma that he'd just been through when people to whom he'd offered hospitality in his own home then break into that same home to kill him. That is something that gives a person pause for thought, obviously. So on the first side, you've got these very, you know, songs like Guiltiness, which numbers the people who are so ruthless that they have no objection to vampiring off everybody to get what... Oh, my God. To get what they want. Sorry.
Okay. This will be so be remembered.
Okay.
Yana,
I'm on the radio now. I'm going to call you back. Bye.
Turn it off. Always say at the beginning, we have talk. Cell phones off. Cell phones off.
Hey, listen, people, I'm so super sorry. Anyway, the fact remains. Let's rewind, operator. We're back at Exodus now. So basically, you have all these strong songs in which Bob unflinchingly confronts how evil and how brutal and how ruthless people can be to one another. Mm-hmm. And then when you get to side two, or the latter part of the album, you get a sense of release, you see. You get the songs like Three Little Birds that just channel joy. You know, the fact that Bob could write, you know, those love songs, and especially things like Three Little Birds and One Love after what he'd been through, it's like almost, you know, giving us access to remember the fact that, you know, no matter how atrocious things get, we are in fact still alive, and we never know what positive thing might improve things tomorrow. Hope.
I think you talk about that no matter what, there's always... He's disillusioned, but he there's always a sense of hope.
That is Bob's humongous gift to us, you see. And I think that's why Exodus continues to be such a powerful album that so many people turn to for strength. The way people, including Bob, turn to the Bible. People can now, and they do turn to Bob's canon, and particularly to Exodus, right, for that.
Yeah, he's been called a prophet.
Oh yeah, in fact he was a prophet. I mean, there's no point mucking about. I mean, he said to me at the time, when I interviewed him, you know, I interviewed him a load of times, and one sticks in my head, he said to me, you know, everything we write about come true. I'm not trying to do the accent, I'm sort of caught between the patois and my English, you know, but give me a break, you know. He said, everything I write about comes true at some time or another. It might not happen right then, but it happens soon enough. Burning and looting, I've seen it happen many times now. You know, the kind of stuff he wrote about in his songs.
Right. You say, you open your book, and I said, I like this. I said, this is very profound. Since leaving this planet, Bob Marley has become one of those mythic cultural figures who take up residence in the collective unconsciousness and flicker in the twilight mental movies of dreamers everywhere. Do you remember that?
I do remember that. It sounds nice the way you read it.
It was well written. So he became a part, as you said earlier, of your collective, your collective unconsciousness. And you also talk about, you know, just going back to the whole concept of Moses, of Exodus, the whole concept of Moses. This is unreal. I don't know what is happening this evening with the telephones. Something is going on.
They love
this
us.
This will be a night to remember. A night to remember. So do you... I'm sorry. Yeah, we're saying that you talk about him and the whole Moses persona and the prophet. Do you want to elaborate a bit on that?
Sure. Well, you know, Bob didn't really like to sort of big himself up too much. You know, he liked to move humble. Mm-hmm. But he was definitely thrust into that Moses role, like it or not. Mm-hmm. You know, he might have squirmed slightly at the comparison, as it were. But, you know, that was his role. He was obviously sent to change the consciousness of generations and to effect a transition, you know, by spreading Rasta. At that time, how radical was that? We forget
that's
now
right, that's right.
What it was to have dreadlocks at that point in time and have him make them sort of trendy for people. But even if people were wearing it to be trendy, somehow it would inevitably spark an internal dialogue and an awareness of what it meant to even be wearing, even if we look at just the hairstyle, you know, which was in a direct line of descent from the Mau Mau, who used to wear it when they were, you know, fighting to change from like Rhodesia to Zimbabwe. That was actually where the first Rastas got the inspiration from. You know, so even just, you know, it's just a different consciousness from wearing like a processed thing.
Oh, definitely, most definitely. As we come to a close, are there any particular sides of the album? Because as I said, you do an analysis of all of the songs on the album. Are there any particular ones that really reach out to you that you like to elaborate on?
Well, I must say that Guiltiness always affects me very, very deeply. Perhaps in part, you know, because I was around when he was composing the song. So maybe because of that, you know, and the passion with which he delivered it when it was in its unfinished form. But those lines really seem to number the evildoers, you know. These are the big fish that always try to eat down the small fish. They would do anything to materialize their every wish. Woe to the down presser.
You're a poet. You're a musician and a poet yourself. And what would you say is you write a lot about Exodus, but the impact of Exodus on other music? Because you're
teaching. I'm so glad you asked me that, because after Family Man explained how they'd done Exodus after listening to Ernest Gold's theme from Exodus, it got me thinking about all the other artists and musicians who'd interpreted Exodus. And in the book, I cover as many of them as I can. I did an awful lot of research, and I discovered that pretty much, literally actually, not pretty much, every single one of them was either a political refugee, as Bob was when he wrote Exodus, or, again like Bob, they were people, messengers, who were sent to help affect a transition and an evolution of consciousness among us, every single one. So Exodus is a very primal and significant theme for us all.
You know, are there any particular artists that you want to name?
Oh, well, I mean, they all really had their, you know, they all really brought something to Exodus, and they really ranged from Rossini doing the opera buffa in Italy at the Napoleonic times to Schoenberg, you know, who wrote it in exile in L.A., and the Guggenheim Foundation refused to give him the funds to finish his Moses and Aaron, so it's still unfinished. And, you know, and our own Isaac Hayes,
yes,
the Black Moses, who speaks very movingly, I think. So, you know, Moses still looms large for us, just like Bob.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And as as someone who teaches music, and who's a musician herself, who are the people who've influenced you in terms of your own development as a journalist, a music, someone other than Bob Marley?
Well, as a journalist, I remember when I was a kid, I used to have the National Union of Journalists a card of George Orwell stuck up by my bed.
Oh, okay.
Penguin had put it out as a poster when they were reissuing him. So, I mean, props to George Orwell. And what were we thinking about music?
Well, yeah, I was thinking more in terms of music, because you did, most of your work has been devoted to Afro-Caribbean and global music.
Yeah. I would definitely say that for me as an artist, I was liberated to do music by punk. So I've got to give props to punk, because punk and females, and in England, this connection between punk and reggae is very strong, and I do talk about it in the book. But I would say even Bob had his part to play, because Bob was always playing his guitar wherever he was, and we would sing along with him, and so I used to get to harmonize with Bob, and that was, I'm sure, a big education for me. So a combination of things like that and punk.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Vivien, for coming into Brooklyn,
yes,
taking the long trek from Queens and coming into the studios of Meg Rivers College.
I am so delighted to be here and finally meet you. Heard so much about you. It's great to be here. And thank you, everybody, for listening to me.
You're welcome. And I want to encourage our listeners to go out and purchase the Book of Exodus, The Making and Meaning of Bob Marley and the Wailers, Album of the Century by Vivien Goldman. And remember, the writer is always writing. The reader is always reading. Keep reading and writing. Empower yourselves as writers and readers. This is Brenda Greene signing off. Writers on Writing.
Inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers.